Freedom to me means self-determination. It's the ability to choose. And I think that that's what we all should have a right to, and that's what we're all fighting for.
Public debate is vital in a democratic society because if the public doesn't take part, then the politicians take over and decide everything for themselves. And a place like the Balie is important because that's where the public gets to say what they think and shape their opinions and listen to debate.
It's incredibly important that people continue to speak out in this way.
Acknowledge the limitations and taking responsibility for questioning the limitations.
With knowledge comes a certain beauty. We are then in a position to take action on that.
Particularly in this very noisy, fast culture, what documentary does, I think, is to take time to make meaning.
Documentaire films en kunst in het algemeen is soms een plek waar de mening en waar de positie belangeloos is. Je mag er gewoon zijn, je mag leren. En de Balie is zo'n plek.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome. I'm very glad you're all here. My name is Jante Mosselman. I'm a program editor here in the Balie. And tonight we're going to speak about literature, literature with a message, literature as amusement, and that sort of things. So this evening was created in cooperation with Uitgeverij Podium. And we're not only making this evening because Manu Joseph's books are magnificent, but also because we were really lucky that he is in Amsterdam. And he is in Amsterdam because he's currently the writer in residence of the Nederlandse Letterenfonds. Hoi, welkom. So what we're going to do, we'll start this evening with Alexander Reewijk, who will give us an introduction. After that, we'll have a discussion, we'll have a conversation really with Naema Tahir and Manu Joseph. And then Kira Buk will close the evening for us. And in between, you will, of course, have the opportunity to ask questions as well. Normally, I would say to you that you have to speak into the microphone because the evening is live streamed. But the live stream is broken. So we're recording it. So you still have to speak into the microphone, please. That's it. I will start by introducing Alexander Reewijk to you, and then I'll introduce the other speakers more properly later on. Alexander Reewijk is author and traveler, and he's published many books on the history of evolution theory, Indonesia and Iran. And at this moment, he is working on a book on South India, and he knows Manu Joseph's work very well, I can say, I think. So give him a warm applause.
Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Is the microphone? Yes, it's working. Well, thank you so much for the opportunity to be here tonight and to speak to you, Manu, and to Naema, and to all you people here. Who are waiting for the discussion between Manu Joseph and Naema Tahir. And I'm really happy that I'm allowed to introduce or have a little introduction. And I thought what I'm going to talk about, and I thought I'll talk about fiction, non-fiction, the position and the differences between the both, and in relation to the meetings I've had with Manu in India and with other people in India. And I just wrote it down, so I'll read it to you. This week, exactly 3 years ago, I took a yellow metro line in Delhi from Jehangirpuri to Huda city center. I entered the metro at Qutub Minar station, traveling south via Maroli, one of the seven ancient cities that formed Delhi, to Gurgaon. I was able to get a glimpse of the foggy Qutub Minar, the large minaret in the south of Delhi, built in the 12th century by the first Islamic ruler of the region. The metro left the outskirts, and I drove through the lush green between the cities, with its country houses, farmhouses, and marriage halls dotted between neatly cut lawns. In the distance, I was able to see the skylines of Gurgaon popping up, a satellite city of Delhi, apartment blocks, malls, and office buildings. And involuntarily, I was thinking of my first trip to India in 1998. I was just graduated, and together with a friend, we traveled through India for a half a year. At that time, it took us almost a half a day to travel from Connaught Place in the center of Delhi to Miroli, to visit the Qutb Minar. Now one covers the distance in about 20 to 25 minutes. The packed metro slowly emptied, and at the terminal station, Hara city center, I left the metro myself and walked under the flyover to the Vivanta by Taj, a posh hotel with a fridge-like air conditioning, where I had a meeting with Manu Joseph, an author of whom I read his novel, Serious Man, and the Illicit Happiness of Other People, and his columns. The idea was to talk about writing and reading in India, and of course, to discuss his work. In the weeks before, I already talked to publishers and authors about books, writing, and reading cultures in India. One of them, Geeta Wolf, owner and publisher of the Chennai-based publishing house Tara Books, told me that young kids in India are not educated in reading novels or looking at art, simply because parents think that they have no time to waste in the rat race for a career in India. Wolf decided to focus on the visual education of young and old. Since 1994, her publishing house has produced many beautifully illustrated books, a lot of them made by hand and illustrated by tribal communities like the Gond from central India and the Vagri from Gujarat. The success, both in India and abroad, is enormous. Editions up to 500 copies of handmade books per title are sold out in recent years. Tara Books created a book building in Chennai, a whitewashed space dedicated to the visual aspect of the book, with a lot of exhibitions and areas for children, and a beautiful shop where they sell all their handmade books. And of course, I know India is a vast country, and this is a small initiative, but at least it's a start. But what about a novel? Do Indians read a lot of fiction? Most people I meet in India, or else in the world, I ask what literary classic from their country I will have to read. It is a deviation that I got from a friend of mine, but it's a great opening line for a good conversation. And whereas the French might come up with books by Balzac, Sartre, or Houellebecq, Iranians will direct you to their great poets like Hafez or Omar Khayyam, and we in the Netherlands probably will name you, for example, Multatuli's Max Havelaar. Most Indians will answer you the Ramayana, the Mahabharata, or the Bhagavad Gita, the great Hindu epics. Now, I think there's no other country in the world where there's such a sacred geography as in India, with all its holy mountains, rivers, hills, and almost all other objects. But still, I was surprised by the answers of people from all layers of society. In a lot of cases, I've learned that they've learned these epics via their grandparents, who told them the stories of Rama, Sita, Lakshman, and their fight against the king of Lanka. Nowadays, it's becoming less common that grandparents live with their grandchildren and tell them the great epics. The oral tradition is replaced by television or sometimes by books. It does say something about the success of authors like Amish Tripathi, a big selling banker who has sold millions of copies of his retelling of the Ramayana, the story of Ram. When I asked him about his success, he told me that it took India and the Indians time to recover from the colonial suppression and the poor economical situation. Getting rid of the pain and the embarrassment and regaining the dignity and keeping the country together took several decades. Now that India is doing much better, the economy is growing, people have more time to show interest in their own history and texts. This is what I had in mind when I met Manu Joseph for the first time in the Vivanta Taj in August in 2015. He was finishing his third novel, Miss Leila Armed and Dangerous, as we know now. I asked Manu how he sees the novel, and he answered, "I see the novel as a grand museum of human failure. And to show this to the reader, you need two components, a mirror and masquerade. I would like the reader to look at him or herself via the novel and persuade them to do so. I would like to seduce them with entertainment, never with messages." On my question whether he succeeds in it or not, Manu answered, "Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. In the end, the reader, him or herself, decides what he or she does with the novel. You know, I received sometimes fierce reactions on how my male characters look at women as lust objects. And of course, you can make a point of that, but you cannot deny the rape culture in India, can you? I can only hold a mirror and people have to look in it themselves. And I think he's correct in that. As an author of nonfiction, you're a much more a sender. The reader can start a dialogue with you over the facts in the text, but as a novelist, the novel, after publication, is out of your hands. It's now of the reader, with his own interpretation, background, and bias. And he can do with the story whatever he wants to and read it at all levels, no matter how superficial or full of misinterpretations in the author's eyes. But as it is difficult to get your ideas to your readers via novels, why do you start writing them? You are a very respected journalist, I asked him. And he said, as a journalist, I've traveled the whole country to cover the news. And at a certain moment, I wanted to write about bigger issues, about systems. But the book after my third novel will be nonfiction. I don't want the readers to overlook the message this time. And yes, nonfiction sells better than fiction. The drop in sales of work of fiction is not only in India. Absolutely not. A couple of months ago, Paul Sabers, a literary agent here in the Netherlands, complained about the status of Dutch fiction. A lot of nonfiction is published, as well as books by TV personalities or other more or less well-known people, football players, cyclists, and so on. I've checked the bestseller list both in India as well as in Holland. Bestsellers in India are books like Immortal India, I Do What I Do, a book on Microsoft, Homo Deus, and a mythological fiction of Amish Tripathi, some young adult titles, and The Ministry of Utmost Happiness by Arundhati Roy as a work of pure literary fiction. In Holland, there are currently two novels, one by Murat Isik and one by Cognetti, the next writer in residence here. Three young adult titles, a cookbook, two thrillers, a Korean bestseller, and a self-help book. But let me focus on India and Indian literature and the value it had for me. I visited India, as I said, for the first time in 1998. And I can tell you I've read a lot of books before I left, mainly non-fiction. Historical books on the Mughals, on architecture, on the British, on partition. I knew my facts. The Mughal emperors, the different states and their capitals, and all the demographics. But I knew nothing about the people at all, even after several months of traveling. And as V.S. Naipaul used to say, it's all about the people you travel among. And that is true. But someone should be able to introduce them to you. And I found out that reading novels helped me a lot. It all started for me with Train to Pakistan by Kushwant Singh. It is published in the 50s, and I read the book while I was in the Punjab, where the novel is situated. In this case, in a little village on the border between India and Pakistan in 1947, in the days partition was established. In clear prose, Singh describes the dynamics in the village when the people realize that the trains that pass the border transport corpses. The book deals about interreligious relations, about the system, and about post-colonial India, with the wonderful observations and dialogues. And it helped me to understand the recent history and how people deal with it in India and Pakistan, at least a little bit. I brought the book back with me to Holland and told several publishers about it. And finally, last year, the Dutch Literature Foundation adopted the book and publishing house Hollandsdiep translated and published it with a grant from SWAP, an initiative to support the publication of unfairly forgotten classics from all over the world. Naima Tahir, here today to discuss with Manu, wrote a very touching and informative personal introduction. And I was named the ambassador of the book and did several book clubs. And I found out that many readers didn't know much about recent Indo-Pakistani history. It led to touching reactions by readers and vivid and interesting discussions, all because of the power of this novel. The second novel is also still clearly on my mind. It's White Tiger, the Booker Prize-winning novel by Arvind Adiga. The book tells the story of Balram Halwai, a village boy working himself up to become a driver and finally a businessman. In a letter to the Chinese leader Wen Jiabao, he writes his autobiography, and in the meanwhile writes about corruption, religion, and casteism in modern India. And after reading the novel, I, for example, was able to see the social structures among workers from all different layers of society on the streets, something I would otherwise never have seen at all. And the last book that I would like to discuss here today is Manu Joseph's latest, the one he was working on during our first meeting, Miss Leila, Armed and Dangerous, an ingeniously composed novel about a young Indian female doctor, Akila, who happens to be a prankster as well, making pranks with people who of themselves think are intensely good, and about a young Miss Leila. When Akila returns from a round of running, she finds out that an apartment block has collapsed. She goes to the ruined building and offers her help. This all takes place in India while Damodar Bai, a populist right-winged politician, wins the elections and becomes prime minister. And I won't go into detail, otherwise I will spoil the story. And I really think people should read the novel. And fortunately, I've seen a lot of people having it here already. And outside is a bookshop who sells the book. And I really think people should read the novel since it gives an interesting and disturbing insight in today's India. I have read a lot of non-fiction books and articles on the RSS, on BJP, on the historical relations between Hindus and Muslims, and the current political state of India. But I never really read about the impact it might have on ordinary people who are at the wrong place at the wrong time. In Miss Leila, one can read about the uprise of BJP and RSS. And of course, Damodar Bai resembles the current Prime Minister Narendra Modi. The lack of serious political alternatives and the increasing fear of Muslims by Hindus. But of course, this is what I have read in the novel, and I hope you will all read the novel and you will be seduced by the humorous style and clear style of Manu Joseph, and in the meanwhile learn a little bit about today's India. It is the power of stories, the power of novels, that constantly will seduce readers in all levels. Stories that will carry you away, make you feel incredibly happy or very sad, or makes you hate a protagonist, or gives you a feeling of great relief that protagonist is not you. But I have to say, overall, I'm very optimistic about reading and writing and novels in India. So I want to finish in a positive way. Well, this is also very positive, but I would like to make a statement. Since a decade, the Jaipur Literature Festival, held in the last week of January, when the weather here is terrible and the days are short, so do visit Jaipur, invites writers from all over the world to discuss with the readers. It started 10 years ago, 12 years ago, with a handful of visitors, while the last festival hosted over 500,000 visitors, mainly from India. I've attended the festival several times, and I was really touched by the eagerness of young boys and girls roaming the festival grounds to find their favorite author or to buy the latest novels for their school libraries. And the Jaipur Festival, founded by William Dalrymple and Namita Gokhale, is a big success, with an offspring of over 100 festivals, literary festivals, in India alone. So to come to a conclusion, do read works of non-fiction, but keep on reading novels as well, since they will show you the effects of big history on the human level. And about you, Manu, you can imagine that I was a little bit shocked when you told me that your next book will be non-fiction. Please do, but I hope that your fifth book will be a novel again. Thank you.
So would you both please join me while I introduce you? Manu, would you sit over here? Yep, that would be perfect, thank you. So Manu Joseph, he lives in New Delhi and he works as a columnist for the International New York Times. He impressed the literary world with his debut novel, Serious Man, and then achieved more acclaim with the novel, The Illicit Happiness of Other People. And today we're talking about this beautiful book, Miss Leila, Gewapend en Gevaarlijk, Miss Leila, armed and dangerous that I really, really very much enjoyed reading. And I'm glad that we can discuss that here. And we'll do that together with Naema Tahir. She was a lawyer for the UN and the Council of Europe, but next to that, she also wrote books. One of their first books was Solitary Present, Eenzaam Heden, appeared in 2008, The Bride in 2011. And this is her latest, I think, Brieven in Urdu, Letters in Urdu. It's a wonderful collection of short stories, so I recommend this as well as a read. So, Mr. Joseph, my first question. If you would describe your latest book to us, could you do that briefly? What is it about?
Well, how much time do you have?
I have a lot to ask, so.
Yeah, you know, that's always a tough thing to do, actually.
Why?
Because there are a lot of things that go into the creation of a novel, actually. Sometimes when you present your novel, it always sounds very intellectual and very intelligent. But when the novel is created, it could be for very simple reasons. Like, for example, the first book was born out of my own anger. Because in my 20s, I lived in what is called a vertical slum in Bombay. And I would listen to posh Indian writers talk about jazz and talk about cosmopolitanism and talk about concepts which were very alien to me because I saw a different kind of India. I lived with a different kind of people. You stand in line for the toilet, you know, and which was very romantic also because there was a girl's line and the boy's line. And you see people in the morning and it's a very different kind of Bombay that I saw, for instance. And the second book was born out of an argument in my head that the world is actually influenced by mad people and we are all lost. Actually, we are all screwed because if we are sane, we are trying to imitate the insane. And these days, mad people are not called mad. They are called CEOs or politicians or activists. They have various names. They're very passionate about their madness. We think we are passionate. They are passionate about something else. And lovers, you know, we have so many expectations. Like, for example, I don't know if you're familiar with Hindi films. There was a song where when people are in love, they start singing and standing in geometric circles, and they dance, which is exactly what we do when we are in love. So there used to be girls in Madras, after they get married, they get very worried, saying that my husband doesn't love me because we are not running around trees. Because they thought that when you get love,
you start running around trees.
Yeah. So anyway, so it's a very, very long answer to your question. I'm trying to avoid the. but I actually, as a journalist, I hate news. That's a fact. Because it's the greatest fiction around. Because journalists fabricate news. I think I believe that. News is actually rare. Actually, that is the very definition of news. It's rare, so it's news. But we've created so much of news that I feel that it's a fabrication, and I had this beautiful thing, like a novel, and I really didn't want to do anything topical, anything political. I wanted to do something else. But then, in 2014, there was this man who was rising in India, who you might know in terms of public perception. If there is a parallel, it will be Lord Voldemort in Harry Potter, where a very, very interesting figure splits the society into two, into what is called, I think labels are very lazy, but what's called the right wing and nationalists and people who usually don't look posh. And the other side, which is part of a global monoculture where they're all the same across the world. They have very sophisticated views and they always say the right things. They had a certain view, and they thought that if they, you know, the people who say the society is polarized, they usually think they are not polarized themselves, but they are. And so I'm sitting there and looking at all this, and I could not escape the magnetic field of this thing which is happening in my society, because what I really like in human beings is insanity. I find that very interesting, especially when they don't know. It's insanity, you know. Of course, that means that I'm claiming that I'm sane, which is my claim, I'm very extremely convinced. It's something none of my former lovers agreed with, but I'm totally convinced that, in fact, I also feel sometimes sanity is a minority condition. We'll come to that later. So I'm watching all this. At the same time, I had this girl in mind who is pretty athletic and who loves playing pranks on people, because in a coincidence, I also love pranks. I feel that you get more out of people when you play a prank than actually even in a literary or intellectual inquisition. You surprise a person. I always feel that if you really want to know what your lover thinks of you, you should just piss her off. And the next 5 minutes, what you get is the perfect analysis of what she actually thinks of you. That's why seasoned couples, they're actually always trying to get along, because nobody can handle the truth, you know. Similarly, in prank, I think there are a lot of things about people which I think is closer to truth. Prank, I would elevate prank to anthropology, because literature is whatever it is. It's a performance, it's an intellectual, there's decorum in it, but prank is very crude. And so I thought it'll be very, very interesting to bring prank into fiction and see what happens. And also, at the same time, I was going through, as a journalist, I had pissed off a lot of liberals. And I also wanted to make fun of them. I just changed the names. And I think it's very easy, also, actually, it's very easy to challenge evil, right? People who are clearly identified as evil. But I feel that in today's world, evil also triumphs, because good is hiring very poorly. If you want to stand up to some dark forces, you need very smart people to do that. So I wanted to bring all this in a novel, and I didn't do any of this, which is what my claim is, because I respect the story. I'm a storyteller, and I'm in a profession where the story has become very esoteric, very artistic, where someone says that, oh, this is my thought, and this is a stream of consciousness, and the novel is over, you know. But I'm a conventional storyteller, where Jack goes to the market is not a story, you know. Jack goes to the market, and something remarkable happens. And for the past 10,000 years, that was our definition of a story. It's something bloody interesting, you know. And I feel that I have a lot of things to say, but to win the right to say it, I will also give you a story. Of course, I also enjoy doing that. That's it. Sorry. I promise my answers are usually not so long. It's just that I was completely taken aback by the...
By the way, how the story arose. And if you talk about this book, would you say it is about a society that's broken into two?
Yeah.
In what way?
Okay, I thought that was for the same reasons which I mentioned, where people are influenced by mad people, and I don't say mad in a bad way, though. I know I should say that. I also mean that it is I usually say psychiatric condition, and that sounds very medical, you know, and very. It's just that some people are motivated by the psychiatric state, and only they have the power to influence people. And they manage to influence people because people go through many things. Like, for example, Alexander mentioned a popular Indian writer, Amish's analysis, why a lot of people read his books. Because he deals with mythology and all that. And Indians now have the time to read about their own country. That's not a perfect analysis. I think he also sells a lot because he puts things nicely like this, right? But I think a lot of complex things are going on right now. The Indian middle class is a drama, you know. The Indian middle class, I mean, where it's extremely,
it's good that it happens now.
It's actually a bit cheap to be rich in India, which the first hippies realized when they went in search of truth to India. Should know why they went. They always go in search of truth to third world countries and not to rich countries for a reason. It's easy because you go with $100 and it goes a long way. So the Indian middle class is very pampered. It's used to, they have servants, they have drivers whom they treat very badly. And one part of the middle class, having appointed these people to take care of them, also wants a revolutionary, you know, who pick up arms for them to fight their causes. And there are other kinds of people who become very invested in the idea of home. My generation, they're much younger than I look. When I say my generation, it might seem like someone who's very old, but then a few, not very long ago, all my classmates, they just wanted to go abroad. And they wouldn't know who the chief minister is. They wouldn't know anything about politics. But now, but then they realized in Europe and America, there's too much equality. An Indian middle class guy has to just step out of the house. The entire society knows you are someone special. There's a lot of respect. But this guy goes to America and he's in a restaurant. And even the waiter is rude to him. A waiter is never rude to a middle-class person in India. So they couldn't handle this equality, for instance. So they started loving home. And that is in the heart of Indian nationalism. The new Indian middle class knows that India is home. And the idea of home has returned very strongly to the Indian middle class. And on the other side, there were a lot of people who were very rich earlier in India. They have become poor relatively because the new money has overtaken them. And they are pretty pissed. So they are looking for ideological reasons to condemn the new money. So that is the other side of the middle class. Mm-hmm. So these are the things which are going on, and that's how they are split. It's not aesthetic. But I suppose that's how it is.
And when you were writing this book, did you want to make it a political book? Did you want to have this struggle in the middle of it? Is it a political book, I should ask first?
I would say it's primarily a thriller. Mm-hmm. You know, I would say it's a car chase. It's a chase novel. It's essentially, if I can introduce a synopsis, or no? Mm.
No? Okay. Maybe a little bit. Okay. Don't spoil it all.
Okay, I won't spoil it all. There's this building which has collapsed, and the collapsed building, there's a guy who's dying, and he's mumbling something, and only Maya Akila, the athletic girl, can reach him, because the soldiers have dug a tunnel, but only a small person can go inside the tunnel, and they need to keep him alive. And she goes, she hears what he's mumbling, and what he appears to be saying is he's giving out the real-time movements of a young Muslim couple. And apparently they're going to blow up something. And apparently, based on this, an intelligence official is shadowing this couple. So that's the novel. Where's the politics in it? Where's the politics?
Well, it's a young Muslim couple, for instance.
Yes. So young Muslim couple is not a political entity unless you add a dimension to them, and then it becomes very political in India. Yes, but you're right, absolutely right, because they are Muslim and there is, you connect Muslim and, there's something in the bag, that becomes very political suddenly. And of course, there is this character in the backdrop who is this powerful nationalistic figure who's rising in India. And as I always say, all the characters in my book are fictitious, and any resemblance to the Indian Prime Minister is completely coincidental. So all these characters are there, which probably makes it political. But if I had not got this idea of a thriller, probably I wouldn't have written it.
So it can only coexist.
I'm sorry?
It can only coexist.
Yes.
So exist together.
Yes. Yes.
Naima, I want to ask you, because I think your work maybe used to be more political than your latest work. I don't know if you agree. But when you write, do you think your work has to be political in a way, or should it coexist? What do you think?
That's interesting. I wanted to say something about his book to make people buy it. and then I'll answer that question.
Okay.
I won't say what the book's about, because as a writer, when I read a book, I tend to read it on technique. How did he write this? How come this dramatic event is so funny? How come his sentences are nice and short so that you can see the pace? And how come in a few pages you see Muslim, Hindu, and the pluralism of India? Why you should read the book is because it gives a picture of a changing India, an India we actually don't know. We know an India of the curries and an India of, nice saris and warm weather and lovely colors, and it's very photogenetic. And my view of India is also very, very limited. I mean, I'm an immigrant's daughter, people who came from Pakistan, and my image of India is, the country from who Pakistan partitioned. And I read Indian novels just to learn about the contemporary society. And I think you've really given that picture to me, and I hope everyone reads it, and I'm going to write something about the novel later. So to answer your question, when I started writing, I was a practicing lawyer, and I didn't have this plan of writing. I just wanted to become a lawyer, and I did, and I, earned a lot of money, which I did. And then suddenly 9/11 happened, and I'm a Muslim immigrant, and I wanted to enter into that debate, which I felt was too black and white. People blaming the Muslims for not being democratic or human rights oriented enough, and then the other side saying, well, there's no issue. So I wanted to give my contribution to that debate as an immigrant's daughter living in the West with a Muslim heritage. So those were political essays. And then suddenly something just happened. This Pandora's box opened and I started writing novels. And obviously there was this urge to show a message. And then I'm a human rights lawyer, so my books were all tainted with this human rights message. And then something happened a few years ago. I started working on my PhD, and I took a break from the debate, and I noticed that I was finding a different voice. And I think my voice is really found in my last novel. And this one is about, just the narrative, just the stories about what is it like to be an immigrant, and what are the lives of migrants, and how do East and West meet each other in the daily things, and how does, my first story is about a set of twins, two brothers, Pakistani. They live in Lahore, and the eldest, you know, they're twins, but the eldest marries and moves, migrates to Detroit and becomes a normal, successful, you know, American Pakistani. And his brother, who lives in Pakistan, remains there. He feels that, you know, this is a divorce. I'm divorced. My better half is somewhere else. And he totally fails in life. And I just write now, not with this political message, you know, allow the borders to be open for immigrants. I just write so that we can learn about life. We can learn about human beings, the human condition, the shortcomings of human beings. And literature is a great way to do that, because we can, as Alexander was saying, you know, you can really relate to literary characters. It's more personal. It might not sell as well as nonfiction. I think you said that, or you said that. But it does, it touches you on a different level. And everyone who, you know, I speak to a lot of people who say, I just want to read nonfiction or fiction which is based on a true story. Even those people are drawn to fiction. Fiction tries to capture the truth. So when I write, to come back to you, and I'm sorry for such a long answer. There was a political urge when I started writing, but I'd like to forget those books. So even when I send out my biography, I just mentioned the last book. So I'm kind of starting afresh. And I write now just to show people, you know, what the world is about, what the life is of an immigrant. So I don't write to change the world. I just write to show what the world is like. So,
is that, does that count for you as well, that literature is a way to touch people on a different level, to show the world?
That's what writers say. I believe some of them, and I don't believe some of them.
Mm-hmm.
I personally don't know why I write. It's just something I do.
Mm-hmm.
And I have, because I get this question often, I have tried to prepare in the bathroom on what I would say to this question.
Okay. Why
for
you
the
should,
last 10 years.
Why do you write this question?
What could be a very good answer to what I write, if someone, or something which is both nice and honest. And I've not, strange, I've not come up with anything. It's just that it's something which I just do, because maybe because I can't do anything else.
Okay, I'm going to ask a side question then. But what would happen if you wouldn't be able to write? So you wouldn't, so you'd be locked somewhere, and you didn't have a pen and you didn't have a paper?
No, if I'm locked somewhere, I would rather at least have long hair so that someone comes and rescues me. I don't have that option either. I think I would definitely be a filmmaker.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the interesting thing. If the films also are not available,
mm-hmm.
and
you wouldn't
and
be able to tell stories.
No, that's the thing. If there is no way, like birds fly, we talk, you know, and so some people will not be able to have. Maybe I've become a politician.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm not able to become a straightforward politician, may I become a corrupt politician, which is actually what corruption in India is. It's a compensation. For in India, if you're not very lucky, if you're not born to the right home, there is no avenues for you to earn decently.
Mm-hmm.
So the so only two options. If you are a genius, you become a sportsperson. And if you're not a genius, you become a corrupt politician, where it's a it's an economic compensation. So what I'm trying to say, not that I would have certainly become a corrupt politician, but I would have found some avenues, just because politicians are storytellers. Let's mm-hmm. not forget Trump. One way of interpreting Trump is that one set of story triumphed over the other set of story. Actually, it was all about storytelling, wasn't it?
But speaking about storytelling, the stories you both tell and we might not know why you do that or we expect why you do that. They're about underdogs in a way.
Yeah.
They're about people who don't have a voice like Trump or like a politician. So I'm interested in that. So why do you write about these people?
Well, I think, and I see that generally in the writers I interview and I read, and I think for my, and maybe it's also, I'm an outsider, and I see a lot of writers who are outsiders in some way or the other. And in my case, maybe because I was a migrant. I started as a migrant in England, then we came to Holland, then you were double outsider, because then in England, if you're of Pakistani or Indian heritage, you belong to the dominant migrant groups. But when you come to Holland and you are Pakistani, you become a minority amongst the minorities. You are not even mentioned in statistics. So that was a kind of, I had to really, you know, adjust to that. I'm still adjusting to it. So there's this outsider aspect. So when one becomes an outsider, you kind of take this critical distance, and you're viewing your society. You're viewing things which are going right, which are going wrong. So I was drawn to that. And then, you know, I studied law because of that. I wanted to study law because of, you know, these injustices and the differences I found between men and women, for example. But just injustice, poverty really drew me, because as an immigrant, you know, we have an easy life. We do become, you know, easy. But as you're talking about India, it's hard to, even in Pakistan, it's hard to become, if you're not connected to the right families, to the right biradari, which is a kinship group, if you're not, you know, in those middle class or upper middle class elite circles, it's really tough. You just put up your own business. And parents struggle to educate their children. And there are two professions. You either become a lawyer or a doctor. I don't know, maybe that's the same in India. That's what you do. And I've seen my family in Pakistan sometimes struggle. And they have dreams. And sometimes they share their dreams. You know, I want my daughter to become a pilot. And I sit there and I think, if I have the dream for my daughter, it will probably become true, because she's living in, you know, a country of opportunities. And there's a difference with daughters of my cousins, and that poverty or lack of opportunity, those are also things which, you know, those are outsiders in a certain respect. So I wanted to write about these injustices, about outsiders in all walks of life. And yeah, so that's why, you know, the migrant narrative for me, it's the closest to me. But it's not, you know, just the travel to the West and then the meeting of West and struggling with modernity versus tradition. There are very, very many aspects. When one becomes a migrant, you have a certain status. And in the olden days, 25 years ago, when I went to my home country in Pakistan, you know, everyone looked up to you. Older people would look up to me because I lived in Holland. It's very hurtful. It's very hurtful. No one writes about that. So I wanted to capture those injustices.
Manu, are you an outsider as well?
yeah, actually, even in my star sign, in fact, I'm supposed to, my sister says I'm Cancer, but all the Leo people say you must be Cancer, and all the Cancerians think I'm Leo. And I feel even... many times I'm very comfortable in that space, though I must say that.
And you're saying.
Sorry.
That's all right.
Yeah. I'm sure you can still hear me. Yeah. So, and also, as she said, I mean, the entire Indian upper class is sexually transmitted. You know, so it's more interesting to tell the story of others it's more interesting. It's very simple, as simple as a bat. On the thing of the underdog, I think all of us feel we are underdogs. It just depends on the context, you know. So almost no story is possible without the underdog. It just completely depends on the circumstances, and we all rate ourselves as underdog. I'm sure if someone is attempting, when you mentioned Trump, I was wondering now, does Trump violate this theory? Imagine if someone gave you $1 million to write a novel on Trump, how will you make it succeed? I was thinking it would be very difficult to write it if you're a woman, but I think there is a possibly, imagine a middle-aged guy who's actually lonely and stupid, who at times feels extremely confident, and he always ends up doing all the wrong things, and he has no hair, and he feels being bald is the worst thing a man can be, as he keeps telling other balding guys, and you should comb up, and this is better.
And he can't really live up to the job.
Exactly.
He
was lucky boy. He was also an underdog. Don't forget, he said, my papa gave me only $1 million to start my business. And it's a very honest statement coming from him, because maybe he doesn't understand anything which is under $1 million. From Trump's point of view, though he might have lied about that also, maybe it was $5 million. But he thought he was an underdog, that he created all this wealth from nothing. So he has this. Even Trump thinks he's an underdog. So I think a novel is possible if it is not a farce. Actually, strangely, this novel will work only if it is somewhat serious. And the thing is, if you tell a story from the point of view of a person, you begin to like that person. In fact, that's why in my novel, I wanted to also tell the story from the point of view of the character who is fictitiously based on the current Indian Prime Minister. But I didn't end up doing it because I thought I will like that guy. At some point, you can't spend 3 years with a character you hate, you know.
Would you read something that we discussed?
I'm sorry?
Would you read something?
Yeah, I can. Yeah.
But where's the book?
Oh, thank God, yeah. My Dutch is very bad.
I didn't think about that as well.
I'll just choose the part. I'm sorry, I have to find this.
It's all good.
No, there is a part that she wanted me to read.
There was a part of that
she wanted to challenge me on that.
Oh, sorry.
Do you remember the page number?
I can't remember. I have it somewhere. You know what we could do now, Emma? Would you mind reading now, and then I'll ask something about that, and then if you find it, we can.
So there's a tragedy in my life, and that's my books are only in Dutch, which is also a good thing because it makes me translate my own work. So Brieven in Urdu, letters in Urdu, 5 short stories, and I've translated a few of the stories, and I'm sending them in to literary magazines. The first story is about these twins, Chota and I forget the name of the other one. How can I do that? How can that possibly happen? Chota and Bai. So Chota means small, Bai means brother. I kind of took really fictional, non-existing names because I didn't want my family to say, oh, this is about me, this is about me. And as I said, Bai moves to Detroit after marrying an American Pakistani, and his twin brother Chota remains in Pakistan, and he fails in life and starts working in a factory, and his son also works in a factory. So it's also about real poverty in Pakistan. Dia is the mother of the son who works in a factory and the wife of Chota. So I have to put it far away because I'm kind of becoming old, even if it doesn't seem that way. Okay. It's really Oh, this is like 16, 16 on the.
Do you need more light?
No. I just need my reading glasses, which I don't have. Sorry. The story is called Three Chapatis, Three Thick Chapatis. Dia left 3 days of food behind. Three thick chapatis, though her son Bara preferred those fluffy thin ones. But fluffy thin chapatis go dry quickly. Twiggy at first, hard as bark within a day. Even dipping that bark in vinegar makes them no less tough to chew. Dia had wrapped the chapatis in a linen cloth. It had a blotchy-blocked pattern in greens and reds, a cloth Bara, her son, knew well. He knew his food would be in there when he returned from his nightly shift. His mother had also left some pickle for him. Bara never minded much about what he got. He was even used to eating his chapati with just water. Still a boy, he devoured anything, for who is hungry will eat with ease. There were times when Dia was barely able to scrape together a meal for her family. Then, too, Bara would lick his lips over boiled rice, seasoned with no more than salt. Dia had wished she had some dal left for Bara, but there was none. The last bits of it were spread onto the two chapatis she had made for the family's trip to Sialkot. On the bus, her husband Chota had immediately finished those chapatis, together with their three-year-old son Larka, who, like his father, could hardly save food for later. During that six-hour journey, Larka kept asking for something more to eat. Dia nursed him once, twice, thrice, and after she had also nursed Kaki, her baby, she was becoming rather hungry herself. Usually she could go without food for a whole day. Not this time. Her legs became restless, and because she was not allowed to stretch them like the men could on the bus, she sweat heavily and felt faint. Finally, at one bus stop, she whispered to Chota to get some roasted chickpeas. 5 rupees they had cost him, and Dia was overcome with guilt. She only took a few chickpeas to suck on and watched calmly as Chota and Larka feasted on the rest. Shall I go further?
A bit, yeah? I think.
Chota had taken 3 days off, 3 days without pay. On the way to Sialkot and the way back, he would earn nothing. During the Eid festival, which they would celebrate at his mother's, his wages would be docked too. They would have to tighten their belts and spend the day inside once they were in the city. After all, the streets filled with temptations was all the more risky for the poor. They hadn't even brought gifts along for his mother Amma, nor for the rest of his family. But each and one of them knew what had become of Chota. It had been more than 2 years since they had been in Sialkot. 2 years of missed Eids. Years in which they hadn't even tasted its summer mangoes. They could have gone, had they scrounged off a brother or a sister or a cousin. But this Chota could no longer do. For every rupee they give me, I must take 1,000 rupees of scorn.
Thank you. So this story, for me, is about people who also suffer under a certain system and they cannot get out. But this is because they both work in a close company, well, the father, Chota, yep, and his son, where they make little money, and these are the consequences of that. But you describe a system in which, well, I would say we, when we buy cheap clothes, are partly responsible for. Is that one of the reasons why you write this?
The reason why I put in the child labor aspect is because that's one of the things which is known from the human rights scene. Child labor was an issue in Pakistan. They were making footballs. Children were making these footballs, and then there was a whole clear up from the International Labor Organization. So Pakistan is known in the West for a few things, and one of them in the human rights scene is this child labor. So that was just a base of the book. But I wanted to add a new dimension. Yes, it's true that there is a system in that country where, you know, poor people, it's a struggle for them. But I wanted to connect that to migration. I wanted to show a picture of two brothers, one migrating, and we tend to focus on the migrant. You know, how is his life in the West, you know, in America? How has he learned English? Did he meet someone? You know, how did he meet people? How did he struggle to adapt? Was he accepted in a community? We like to read those types of immigrant novels, you know, and we forget the people left behind. And I wanted to draw in that person. We are all connected to people left behind. And the differences are sometimes so huge that they become embarrassing. And while Chota should blame his own society for his position, he's kind of blaming, well, if I had migrated, this would not have happened to me. So migration enters his life also. So there are a few complexities I wanted to weave into this book.
And was there something you wanted your readers to be left with?
The complexity and, you know, the beauty and the tragedy of migration. It's beautiful. I mean, I love being in Holland. I've had great opportunities here. I'm a Dutch person. I write in Dutch. Migration is, I always say migration is beautiful, but it's also cruel. And the cruelty we focus on is the cruelty of, you know, we don't integrate and we feel not at home in our country. But the cruelty I wanted to add in this book is we're connected to people left behind. You know, for example, my grandparents passed, and I couldn't go to the funerals. So we would go, and I remember my grandmother passed away, I think it was 2005. And it's only last year, in December, that I went and I was consoling some of my family members who I hadn't seen in 2005 on the passing of my grandmother in 2005. So it's things like that. We're connected to a country and a family and experiences left behind. So that is what I wanted to communicate. I, as an immigrant, I feel that I need to share what it is like to be an immigrant, the beauty and the tragedy of it.
Do you think these stories are too often lacking?
You know, I think there are a lot of stories out there. I think we don't read enough. I don't read enough myself. I don't think we read enough. I think we have, maybe in the olden times we would tell stories to each other. Maybe that was the tradition, but we should just read more. I wrote a piece about Europe last year in the newspaper, and I said, we travel to European countries for holidays, but how much do we really know about Italy? How much do we really know about Germany, our neighbor country? How many Dutch people have read a novel written by a contemporary German novelist to learn about German society? It's probably the only way to learn of a society. You know, this book by Levy, what's his name? Is This a Human? He wrote about his life in the concentration camps. As a school kid, we were taught about the Second World War and about the Jews in concentration camps. But it was only when I read that novel, a novel of the daily life of how it was, that you really get this strong picture of reality. So I think there is a lot of story out there, classical, contemporary. We just don't read enough. And that's why I loved what you were telling about literary festivals in India. They're the same in Lahore. I spoke to a very nice author, whose name I forget again, Mohsen Hamid, last year. And he was telling that if there's a literary festival in Lahore, 3,000 people will come into a venue which is only, you know, only 1,000 people can sit there. And then when it's done, you won't see it's happening here, but then people will be knocking on the doors and there'll be 10,000 more, and they'll say, run the show again, because we also want to you know, experiences. There's something really interesting happening on the Indian subcontinent, maybe even in Nigeria, maybe even in other countries, unexpectedly in the literary scene. We are reading and wanting to read and wanting to write more novels. And that's a great thing, because it teaches us about who we are, about us. It teaches us about humans.
Thank you. Did you find it?
Yeah, I did, actually. No, I must say, I can see very well, you know, so that was not the issue. I had to really, because I had I had worked a lot on the placement, so these pranks can go anywhere. Yep, so should I?
If you want to, please.
Are you sure you want me to read? Because I don't know if audiences like to listen to things being read out. Or maybe we can take a referendum. If it's 52%, it's a bad idea. Okay, so this Akhila Iyer, she plays pranks on the good guys, all the guys, activists, and noble people. She has her own reasons, as it usually happens with a 25-year-old girl. It's usually a problem with the mother, and it is in her case. It is that, but we won't get into that. But she plays pranks on the good guys. And there is this right-wing person who is watching a video on her on YouTube where she posts all her pranks, and this narration is his from his point of view. He's a right-wing patriarch. Okay, I have to switch on my mobile light, actually. Oh, can you turn
on
the light?
Can we do a light here?
Oh, this is fine. Did anybody? Okay. You did? The light is on?
We tried, yeah, oh, but okay. I don't know if it's enough.
Okay. The highway to Bombay passes through vast flatlands. Professor Vaid, that's the name of the ideologue, gapes at the rice and millet farms, which look glorious and self-important. But they're only waiting for the day when they will become real estate. The village romantics, who usually live in the cities, can't bear the thought. The romantics wish everything to remain the same because it is aesthetic that way. Ms. Iyer has harmed several village romantics, chiefly in a set of pranks called the Nobel series, in which she fools the pious socialists into believing that they have been chosen for the Peace Nobel. It is fascinating to see how the nice chaps behave when they are told they have won the Good Behavior Prize. For one of the pranks, she deploys three white men and two white women, all of them middle-aged tourists she had collected from a cheap hostel in Colaba, which is in Bombay. She takes them to meet P. Satya, whose malady of interest is rural affairs. He's a serious humanitarian with an accidentally fashionable hairstyle. Like every philosophical thug of Miss Laila, he despises large corporations, agriculture reforms, land reforms, biotechnology, and the fact that rich men wish to acquire land. He wants small farmers to remain small farmers, half naked in their tiny hamlet. He has, of course, won the Magsaysay. It's something all the good boys in India win. Satya is alone in his office when Miss Iyer herds the foreigners in. She has concealed a tiny high-resolution camera in her spy bag, which has an aperture for the camera's lens. Satya's assistant, a thin, excessively reverential man, ushers them in and leaves the room. Satya is gracious. He is under the impression that a group of professors from Norwegian University wishes to meet him to understand the trauma of Indian farmers. He is good with traumas. He loves traumas. We have been a bit disingenuous, Miss Iyer's voice says with an accent that she wishes to pass off as Scandinavian. We are not from a university. This is an unfortunate custom we need to follow in our line of work, sir. I don't understand, Satya says, still very gracious. She says we are in reality from a committee set up by the Norwegian Parliament. I'm just a regional facilitator. I live in Oslo, but I was born here in Mumbai. These are not the members of the committee, but representatives of the members. Satya looks bewildered, but he's an informed man. A great but elegant excitement begins to descend on him. Mr. Satya, she says, we are from the Norwegian Nobel Committee. A solemn man says, Satya, still pretending that he does not know what is going on, throws a glance at the window at a distant time as though in quiet reflection of his whole life. Mr. Satya, a woman says, the Norwegian Parliament and the Norwegian Nobel Committee are honored to confer the 2014 Nobel Peace Prize on you for your lifelong dedication to the welfare of Indian farmers. Two remarkable things occur. Satya believes them at once. It is as though he always carried in his heart the hope or conviction that this moment would arrive. The other remarkable event is that he begins to cry. Upon receiving news of an extraordinary recognition, the selfless weep in joy, inadvertently revealing the impossibility of selflessness. The woman requests Satya not to break the news to anyone until 4 hours later, when an official statement will be issued from Oslo. You can tell me anytime, I'll stop, okay? In about 4 hours, because this is a part which really upset some people back home also, so. In about 4 hours, the working day in Oslo will begin. Ms. Iyer said, we will convey the news to the world then. We just want to meet you to confirm that you accept the award. I accept. Satya says, wiping his eyes with a kerchief, I accept. The reason why Ms. Iyer met him so early was probably to ensure that the real Nobel Committee would not be in a position to deny the news if Satya leaked it in his excitement. The prank has a second part, which is its core. She sets up a Skype appointment with him, claiming that the Nobel Committee sitting in Oslo will formally break the news to him. 4 hours later, the Skype interview begins. Satya's face, which has acquired extreme compassion, appears on the screen. Yes, I'm here, he says, but I can't see any of you. I think the video is off. That's unfortunate, the voice of Ms. Iyer says. The whole committee is present. They can see you from Oslo. The group who met you today in the office, we sit here in this conference room at Taj Hotel. We can see you too. Hello, Satya says, meekly wondering what he must say to invisible, influential Norwegians. Hello, committee. Something has come up, sir, Ms. Iyer says with reference. There is an issue, sir. What issue, madam? You are a propagator of a concept called farmer suicide. What do you mean by propagator, madam? You have propagated the idea that Indian farmers commit suicide because they are in debt. I have not propagated anything, madam. I have been, she interjects, but several studies have disproved. She then now goes on to basically say that his analysis of Indian farmer suicide is wrong, and that people commit suicide because of depression and not because of debt. And she establishes that Scandinavian countries have higher suicide rate than the suicide rate of India's poor. Ma'am, what are you trying to say? There's a concern that you've created the myth of farmer suicide to milk it for your activism like other fucker doodle fuckers. Excuse me, madam. And why did you cry when you were told that you're giving you the Nobel? You want it much? And he's like, what's going on? What the hell is going on? You sound angry, sir. He says, what the hell is going on? Sir, this call may be recorded for quality and training purposes. What? This call may be recorded for quality and training purposes. It's very strange. It's very silly to laugh at your own stuff, but I never laugh when I was writing, actually. I never read this out. So this is really weird. I've never ever laughed when reading my own piece. Sorry. It sounds very pompous, actually. Yeah. It's because I can see his face, you know. I've never trusted men with hairstyle, actually.
No, that's...
So then he says, is this some sick prank, you semi-literate corporate bitch? No, this is exactly what he would say. So she says, no Nobel for you.
Thank you.
Can I ask him a question?
Yeah, of course.
So how courageous do you have to be a writer of, you know, so many different religious characters in a country which is religiously plural, of course, but there are issues? How courageous, do you find yourself courageous or don't you even think about stuff like that?
I do not think. I also believe that probably there is no such thing as courage. There's either stupidity, which I'm capable of, but seriously, there's also gamble. And gamble is what journalism trained me for in India, which also one of Pakistani writers, Mohammad Hanif, he also takes, I think yeah. He takes major gambles. You know, yeah. both our countries are so screwed up. So what happens in India is, now just like, I don't know if you've ever visited India, you know that there's no system on the road, as in we drive on the left. You can also drive on the right. Google Map has started saying it. Mm-hmm. Google Map at one point said, take the left and then go on the wrong side of the road. You know? So the lack of system, you can also use it where you know that to assassinate a person or to harm a person also requires a certain system and investment. So you take your gamble where you feel that, as a journalist, you feel that, you know, most of the time you can get away. And Monday you get away, Tuesday you get away, but Friday anything can happen. Either, like, I have faced criminal defamation suits, and you can never understand what will get you to court and what will get you harmed. There's been a criminal defamation case against me for carrying a cover where we carried, you know, the India's ruling party, its parent party is called the RSS, and they wear a costume which is, they used to wear a costume where the men used to wear khaki half shots. So we carried a photograph of a man in khaki, and we said something implying that they are trying to create some trouble in some places. And defamation is only a criminal case in India. So I go to court, and there is this RSS guy from the organization who had filed the case, and then he's just chatting with me like an old friend. He says, I love your magazine, I've read Serious Men, and it's like, he just dragged me to court, and then it's something else which is going on, right? And I also once, I wrote, when the last Pope resigned, but he was not supposed to resign, he was supposed to die. And I applied for the job of Pope in a letter to Vatican, mm-hmm. saying that I fully qualify for the job and actually wanted to move into a bigger house. I also told them that, and I said that I've been married for 15 years, so I know celibacy very well. I carried it in my magazine, but they didn't give me the job. But then,
unfortunately,
I got away. But I could have also been sued. Mm-hmm. There could have been a criminal defamation. It's a very serious charge in India for religious disharmony, right? So I don't know why. And so even this, I just tell everybody, don't give them ideas. Mm-hmm. You know, so, but I know that they wanted to send a legal notice, but they decided against.
Not to it. But that's because it's an interesting point that Naima brings up, because you also in this piece, that's why I wanted you to read it, you criticize a lot of holy institutions. You describe something that happens to a Muslim minority that is awful, really. You make fun of the RSS, you make fun of the president.
Yes. Yeah.
Of the Nobel Peace Prize.
So, of the Nobel Peace Prize Committee, yeah. of people, you called them the good guys, and that's a thing that, well, are they the good guys or are they idiots as well, or mad?
No, they are
you
idiots.
Don't really know, but
yeah.
But you said your story just come and you're a storyteller. But then everything is criticized in your work. Not everything, but important things.
That is the role. That is the role of writers. Yeah. You have to search for, you know, you have to look for the answer to how, what is society? How is our society today? What are the patterns? What are the people? And you have to search for the truth. And criticism is giving an honest view. And it's up to the reader to see if that criticism is correct, but you have to criticize. It is the role of a writer. I think you believe that too. That's our responsibility.
I would say that, in fact, I feel that I am stating the truth, you know, where I feel that I'm just stating the truth, and I choose to state a particular kind of a truth in to a particular kind of people because I feel that they are extremely powerful and influential, and, well, you've got my attention, right? So... So it's something also I can't help, you know. I would like to be in a position where I write about, though actually I feel all my stories are actually about love. I do believe that this story is actually, in a way you can interpret it this way, this is about a 19-year-old, beautiful, poor Muslim girl in the wrong car. With the wrong man, you know, and in India you end up with the wrong man, you know, it's like you end up dead. And actually, that was actually more so the drivers of the thing. And these, and what I'm trying to establish through these characters, on the one hand, you have this Damodar Bai, who you know by now is not based on the Indian Prime Minister, and this organization, which again is not based on the RSS. There's a sense of brooding danger because they're no-nonsense people, right, who believe in their own cause. You know, they're not fooling around. And you have these guardians who's like this guy who's being offered the Nobel by Akila. And what is scarier if it is your girl, 19-year-old girl, imagine, you know, she's in the wrong car, in the wrong place. You would think that those scary guys are scary, but I'm also arguing that when you have very weak guardians who claim they are the ones who are going to fight for you, but they are not up to the mark, yeah. That's equally scary for that little, for that young girl who's in that car, you know, because she's the one who's taking for the entire family. Of course, she has her own life, she has her so many dreams. So we have this car which is moving, and we all know that she's in the wrong place.
Car. Yeah.
And we have these dangerous people on one side, and we have the good guys on the other side. And I'm showing that the good guys have no arms. There is no way anybody can save her except herself. And to me, that is scary. Not just evil, which is scary. It is the fact that nobody can fight for you.
And we need better good guys.
Yeah, it's like someone counting on the United Nations to save the country. God help you, you know. It's like someone thinking IMF and the World Bank is going to save the economy. I mean, that's also hilarious. But there are a lot of countries which actually depend on these organizations. We know where that's going to go.
Is there anyone who would like to ask a question? No? Yes? Come fast.
So you were just saying that there's kind of a lack of system in your country, and that means you never really know what you would get caught for. But I was thinking, isn't that exactly the system? Like, so you're always slightly afraid. You don't know what when you're still... in the right space and when you're being too critical?
Yeah, there is the ambiguity is sometimes used as a system, but I don't think they also think through these things so much also, you know. In India, we still... See, we borrowed a lot of things from the Brits and a lot of ideals from European Enlightenment. And then we were like, just because, but we were a completely different culture, you know? So that's why, there's a moment in the book where there is this guy, actually, it's something I observed, you know, in India, the medians. I've always wondered, was you have to just take a white paint and draw a straight line in the middle of a road. But it is always crooked most of the time. Now it's slightly better. You'll always see slight bend here and there. And once I saw a man, he has all the implements. This actually just has to put this, and then you have to just draw the white line, and all the medians will be straight. So I asked him, why are you drawing crooked lines when you're supposed to draw a straight line? And it's a straight road, you know, it's not even a tricky road. So he says, English people have left. Why should I draw a straight line? So it's like we were a crooked line civilization who have been colonized by guys who drew straight lines. Maybe there's some truth to it. It's like maybe we like crooked, like slight things. So it makes us slightly happy. You know, the thing with Indians, when they visit Europe, they love the first 4 days. After the fifth day, they get a bit gloomy. It's all too orderly, you know. In India, when you're in the aircraft, you will see geometric lines. As the plane lands closer and closer, everything becomes unclear. It's all ambiguous, and it keeps Indians happy. We're like a crooked line civilization, you know, slight informality we need, you know. So I think while there is, what you're saying is correct, where some smart bureaucrats use ambiguity to keep everybody on their toes, but we also are not, we prefer, or some there's something about system which does something to our neurological system, you know.
Is there another question? No? Ja, ik kijk even ook de rest van de zaal rond, want we zijn ook al daar nog eentje. Hi, down vast.
Thank you. Steve, with you, you mentioned earlier in the beginning that sanity was a minority condition, basically. Still, do you see any sort of even small pushes of sanity places? I mean, it could be boring. It doesn't have to be very interesting. But on your radar, when you're analyzing your society, do you see even some places where actually you could feel something actually not really serious, but at least real might be of interest? And on the other side, on the Urdu letters, beautiful title actually. On the complexities of identities when you come from another place, living on another land, do you feel there is more and more common ground for discussion of these complexities, despite, of course, the novel, where it's a very good tool of approaching these complex ideas?
Thank you.
You want to take that?
Yeah, you start.
Yeah. On sanity, islands of sanity is as ridiculous as it might sound. Families, actually, you know, and especially in relationships, which are islands, like parents and children, you know, where it's kind of when for things to work, there is a certain, in that context, I feel that there is a lot of importance given to normality, you know, which is the only way it can work. And I feel children by themselves are pretty sane, you know. So those would be the islands, okay. Otherwise, as I said, most of the things are also created by very, very powerful psychiatric conditions, you know. So even people who subscribe to it need to be somewhat in sync with those conditions, though maybe in a milder form, you know. All ideologies. So it's very, it is so influential that it's very rare. That's why personal becomes very important for us to, that's why I feel family and children, you know, these ideas are becoming powerful, at least in many parts of the world.
So as to your question, is there common ground? Are we learning more about the complexity? It's a good question. I would say yes and no. What I see, you know, on a positive note, is that we have never been so connected. You know, different cultures, different ethnic origins. People are, you know, in the classroom. In I teach at a university. There's so many people of different origins. We've never been so connected. But I still feel the need to say that we are not reading enough. And we do learn from each other by each other's stories. We communicate, we talk, but it's all fast communication. I think Alexandra gave the list of the types of books we read. I do it too. I read a lot of cookery books. I do that, you know, I just do that. I should read more novels. But I, as a novelist myself, reading novels is disruptive when I'm writing, because I just keep looking at technique and then I can't read it for the story, so I have an excuse. But you guys don't have an excuse. So there is connection, and through that connection we are learning more about each other, but we should read more to really learn about the complexity we are bringing in, and novels are great for that. So I would encourage, I see it as my responsibility to kind of communicate to whoever, you know, about literature from the subcontinent. Because it's also a reflection of the lives of people who live here. I think, do you agree that novels are the only way to really get to the heart of the complexity? Of course, science too. But who's going to read a scientific book, you know, for pleasure and for entertainment? You also want to be, it's easier, it's more accessible, a novel. So please read more. Films do too, poetry, music, the food culture, traveling, all of those things, all of those ways to connect. But I think the deepest, the most thorough way to know a different culture is really through a book, because it's so patient. It's taken a year or 2 years of the life of an author to really bring in that narrative. So it's really the book which gives us the most.
I'm gonna ask Kiravuk to close in a second, but first I want to ask you, do you agree? Is the novel, is the literature?
I was hoping that I'd get away because...
Unfortunately not. He'll never get away.
You know, it actually depends on whose novel, you know. There was something with Borges, I don't know how you pronounce him here, said about the Quran. He said there's one word you will not find in the Quran, which is the camel. Because the Arabs wrote it, right? So they were not interpreting anything. So it was understood that they were camels. So they didn't have to bring it. Salman Rushdie, when he writes India, there's a certain, apart from the fact that I think monkeys talk and things fly, you know, and some kind of magic realism stuff. He's interpreting it like a Westerner, you know, that's why he's so successful in another culture, because we as authenticity, you know, to complete Borges's view, he said that there is no, he was talking about authenticity, and he said that a local will not explain, or because a local doesn't have to explain, right? Actually, he was wrong. There is, I think, three mentions of the camel in the Quran, but in spirit, his argument is correct. When I was reading A Sense of an Ending by Barnes, well, he just says river, you know, and everybody is supposed to understand it's the Thames, because he's writing for his audience. If an Indian writer says so by the river, the publisher is going to ask which river. You have to set it in place, and you know, this is, you need to explain a bit, you know. So the thing about authenticity is a bit tricky, because it is also sometimes overstated. It is sometimes not possible for anybody who is writing in some certain cultures. So yeah, you can understand some cultures But I suppose it really depends on who you're reading, you know. That's not a very helpful answer, because I'm not telling you who you should read, because that's not my job.
But maybe after the program, people can ask you for new suggestions. Is that okay?
Of course, I would love to. Are we done? I thought someone else would.
Is it okay? No, I'm running late, okay. And I promised that I wouldn't do that. So if it's okay, you can ask the question after the program. Are you staying for a bit to sign?
Yeah, I'm staying.
Okay, that's good. Then I would very much like to ask Kira Wuk to join us on stage. And Naimata here, Manu Joseph, I'm going to thank you now and ask you for a warm round of applause, because it was wonderful to have you.
I'm sorry, I'm going to read the poems in Dutch.
They're in Dutch, and if you cannot understand it, I'm very sorry, but we did want to have a nice closing for the evening.
I was in January at the Literature Festival in India, and those poems are about my time there. Nu ga ik over in Nederlands. Het zijn twee haibuns. Dat is een Japanse dichtvorm waar ik mee aan het oefenen ben. Dat is een beetje proza-achtig. Waar je dan stukjes haiku als een soort uitleiding in verwerkt. Of meerdere haiku's. Sightseeing. De chauffeur spoegt fijnstof uit zijn longen. We rijden door dorpen waar bussen elkaar op een haatje na missen. Dieper het land in. De Israëlische dichter zegt dat hij na een hele ochtend rijden nog steeds niks gezien heeft. Kijk naar buiten, wil ik zeggen. Het is zo'n man die altijd boos is. Die denkt dat de hele wereld hem tegenwerkt. Je ziet het aan de vorm van zijn gezicht. Een boze hond. Koeien leven groot. Ze eten zich vol plastic. Herkauwen de dag. Voor de tempel staat de witte koe met 5 poten. De 5e groeit uit haar rug. Het hoefje bungelt langs haar gevlekte zij. Ze heeft rode poeder op haar kop. Mensen raken de koe aan en doen een gebed. Onze chauffeur blijkt met de bus te zijn verdwenen. De Israëliër zegt dat hij wel gaat lopen en scharrelt een groepje medestanders bij elkaar. Ze lopen de hitte tegemoet, die trilt in de lucht. Als we de bus eindelijk gevonden hebben, zijn al onze blikjes bier leeg. Ze rollen bij elke bocht over de vloer. Donkere wolken halen de zee naar voren. Meisjes spiegelen. We gaan naar een zee die je niet ruikt. De Israëliër vraagt of dit het nu is. Drukt ongeduldig op de klakson omdat hij weg wil. De chauffeur die buiten een sigaretje rookt, schrikt uit zijn roes. Binnen 10 seconden slingeren we bijna tegen een bus aan. Bollywood knalt uit de boksen. Zolang de chauffeur wakker blijft, hebben we een kans. De zangeres neemt een aanloop. Dit gaat goed aflopen of niet, zegt de Indiase dichteres kalm. Ze is risico's gewend. Na het festival ben ik nog een week naar Goa gegaan en Bombay. En dit gaat erover. Goa. Are you on drugs? Vraagt de verkoper van Pasimashaals, terwijl hij alle kleuren onder mijn neus drukt. Ik probeer weg te komen van deze markt die mij als een zwerm achtervolgt. Een Indiase dichter die ik had ontmoet stelde voor om allebei op hetzelfde moment een gedicht te schrijven waarin het woord zwerm voorkomt. Real wool, madame. Here everything is real. Warmte trekt een streep. Op het strand liggen hoogblonde Russen die zich door vatzige Indiërs laten masseren. Ik probeer een blik te raden als ze over de gebruinde ruggen leunen. Ze masseren als deegmachines. De zee is te wild vandaag, dus niemand beweegt. Oude mannen in strakke kooldijgeverfde shirtjes praten over wonderen en het verdrijven van slaapproblemen. Ze hebben alles achter zich gelaten. Hun vrouw, hun bank en pensioen. Kennen de stand van de hemel, maar zitten gevangen in een loop. Dank jullie wel.
U heel erg bedankt dat u hier was. Naima Tahir, Manu Joseph, Alexander Reewijk en Kira Wuk, ook heel erg bedankt voor jullie komst. De volgende Writer in Residence is op 11 september. Dat is Paolo Cognetti. Hij treedt op met... we maken een programma met hem, maar het is in De La Mar. En hij gaat in gesprek met Tommy Wieringa, onder andere. Er wordt gesigneerd. I'm doing this in Dutch. That's ridiculous. I was thanking you. And okay. I'm happy. I'm sorry. Let's have a drink. That's how I would like to close. And see you next time, hopefully.